By way of introducing tonight's guest lecturer, I'm going to read to you from an article that was published 58 years ago. Architecture is the proof of any civilization. If we do not know what our buildings mean, if we have no feeling for a thing wholesome, true, clean, and airy, then what do you expect of us? Architecture begins out of the ground, into the light, by way of a loving mind. Let's say understanding. Love is the perfect understanding. 58 years ago today, Frank Lloyd Wright spoke at this university, and those were quotations that came out of his presentation to the university community. When I read Elizabeth this quote, and hadn't told her who had said it, she said, "Well, that person stole a line out of my presentation this evening." Tonight we have the wonderful opportunity to hear from the progeny of that architectural tradition. We also get to hear from a woman, an architect, who has worked for close to 50 years now on developing her own very strong and profoundly informative professional career. Let me give you a little bit of information about Elizabeth Wright Ingraham. Her career and life has been devoted to using her knowledge to improve and protect the quality of life. Her architectural work includes innovative building systems, energy conservation, and environmental awareness. Her firm is at the forefront of architectural design. As a leader in addressing contemporary issues, she has been a major player in public boards and commissions. As an innovator in her field, she has been involved in major movements over the past three decades. The recognition of the environment as a quality of life indicator, educational reform, and the empowerment of women. Using her strong architectural capabilities as a base, she founded, designed, and directed for 12 years the Wright Ingraham Institute, an interdisciplinary graduate institute on a 920-acre campus known as Running Creek Field Station, and is in a maintenance mode with a large endowment for future use. Some of the things that you would like to know about her in terms of her projects: she has just come from Aspen, where she was working with the Colorado chapter of the AIA, where her firm was recognized and given an honor award for the La Casa project in Pueblo, Colorado. As I said, she's been in the profession for 46 years. She studied under Mies van der Rohe at Illinois Institute of Technology, the School of Architecture there. Registered as a landscape architect in Colorado, Illinois, and Nebraska, and has completed full architectural services for over 130 projects. She's an author. She is a part of the Colorado State Board of Examiners of Architects. She has served as the University of Colorado Dean's Vision Task Force for a new school for architecture and planning. They go on and on. Tonight, however, her presentation, entitled Exploring Place, focuses upon the tradition of architecture as the language of intervention that has modified it, expanded, and brought understanding of cultural, social, economic, and environmental issues, both today and for generations to come. Join me in welcoming Elizabeth Wright Ingraham.
Right, I'm trying to get a card, and it talks about the sense of place. around and said, I said, well, he said, what would you be? I said, well, I think I'll be an architect. And my mother said, oh, how old are you? My father was an architect, my grandfather was an architect, my uncle was an architect. We have a whole family full of architects. And they all did their own time, which is a tremendous body of work. My father also designed Lincoln Wall, which you might have played with, and at the time when he was over at the Imperial Hotel, he designed Lincoln Wall, the 50th anniversary of Lincoln, so he made the Lincoln Wall, and of course, the place that we now have is set for copyright for, and they're now the 50th anniversary. So the family was full of all kinds of activity and all things related to architecture. So it was fairly simple for me to enter that field in my mind. It's not so simple, in fact, because women were not in the field. There are few women, I think, in the field. And so it had been the fight that all women have to move to any professional field. There's still a glass ceiling up there.
Very challenging to all of us. I don't know where we are today. I think very few
know is kept rather aware of the family and their effect. Over the past years in my life, I've used, as many people in my generation, with this travel as a way of identifying myself and identifying the kinds of things you do. I'm quite aware that the place can be a state of mind. I'm not going to talk about that tonight. I'm going to talk rather about place as a very little thing. So primarily because I was asked to show slides, and when you show slides, it skews your talk into a different direction. And so it's easier to find a place and talk about the things that have influenced me, that have made an impact, and the kinds of things that I sought out as an itinerant traveler. I didn't start traveling until I was in my 40s. It wasn't very common in my generation to travel young, unless you were an army brat or you were able to move around the world at a different level than my family did. We were fairly well contained within our regional area. As I grew older and married and had children, I did travel all the 50 states, you know, 49. I lived in Florida. I'm a single trip to Florida sometimes. Some reason or other, Florida's got left out. But I have traveled very widely over the world. And I do think that see architecture as a measure of civilization, so I seek out architecture everywhere. Sometimes the absence of it is a great relief. Because we're able to see the landscape as being space, which is closely identified as place. Place is a physical presence, makes tremendous statements, informs us about the history of human habitat, the human handling of the environment, investing in power, dispersing of wealth. Whether people are cooperative or whether they're alienated, the value of aesthetics. Place can tell you a great deal. And the more you study place and you go, the more this becomes real to you. And it's actual reality. So I want to show you then tonight, not too encompassing in the image of it. Places that I have found and have sought out all over the world. And we'll start now with the slide. So we all know what these are. I don't think focus that they don't look like they focus. Down here, but I guess that's because I'm so close to them. Do they seem to be in focus? Yeah. Something very unusual about seeking out Stonehenge. The monoliths are very famous. Druids, religious symbolism. I was there in the equinox, and it was a fascinating experience being with these stone monoliths. You can't walk up on them anymore, I understand. You can walk up around and get the feeling of them. Not much is known about the Stonehenge. There's a lot of speculation about what's known. Cheops, this is Cheops over here, in Giza, Egypt. The top, this is an extraordinary piece, the source of architecture, really. It's about 450 feet high. That's alabaster at the top. And the alabaster has been covered in the entire pyramid, four sides of the pyramid. When I was 6 years old, my father took me to the Museum of Natural History in Chicago on the film on the pyramid. And I said, I'm going to climb those one day. And my father said, I don't think you can. I think there's a lot of climbing. Well, they didn't allow climbing. And Kofi climbed them at night. And I went up to the Egyptian architect. It was a good thing this night. I said, Ted, I know what I was climbing. I'm going to climb past 5 feet. The stones are 3 feet high. The ledges are about 15 inches. And and it does go with me straight up. You only climb on one side, the other side is a climb on, because the alabaster, of course, stops you from climbing on your way up there. It's equivalent to 45 stories high. And the top is about 18 feet by 18 feet with a large film in the center. Everybody in the universe seems to have carved their initials. We did not carve our initials, but I thought that was environmentally unsound or some such thing. But anyway, we arrived as dawn came over Cairo. Extraordinary sight as Cairo woke up. An extraordinary experience. We came down off the pyramid, walked across the erected. And I spent a good deal of my time in Egypt in the police station somehow. Explaining what I was doing. They were very concerned in 1973 that we were spies or something up there because you could see all of Cairo up there. And we had to prove that we were certainly not spies and that we were excited architects and we were climbing to the funnel. And anyway, we were extricated. Boxes, money, that's where we were, and we get out of the police station. But the whole Egyptian experience, I took seven students over, and two, my old daughter made 12, and the son of a friend who was also 12. They were marvelous integrators, who could integrate amongst the people. It was an extraordinary time with the Pope. And this extraordinary old domes were smashed by the Chinese and are now being restored. I started to take photographs throughout the whole building as I climbed up to the top, and they immediately confiscated my camera. So the camera waited down below while I got finished with the climb. Because there was a wonderful photo opportunity where they restored the gold dust that was black hair from all of the gold everywhere. About 500 gold units, all the handrails, the solid gold. It's quite an experience to go through this. You can see the Dalai Lama's headquarters at the very top being kept for his return, which they trained for later. The Chinese killed about 4,500 monks. There are about 500 left, and only 50 nuns out of 1,000 monks left. I sat in China with the nuns, which was a very interesting experience. It's a thousands of rooms and tremendous. You can't believe this was built. Imagine building this 15,500 foot altitude. You could barely breathe at that altitude. Most people were putting oxygen tanks on. I managed to make it without one, but I began to use the trick to think I probably needed one. But this hotel palace is intact, more or less, although some of them sent the buildings down, and as I say, they're destroying them. But here, this is the building in Lhasa, Tibet. The next place I'm going to show is the Vinh City. The city is China, of course, very old. The Mao Zedong regime is closed down, about to deteriorate, and now reopens, of course, because it's a great tourist event, so people come. Not just tourists from the country, tourists from China. China's own, people will travel from one zone to the other, and it's not allowed to because of the job placement. So they're interested in their own country as outsiders. So most of the tourists are Chinese coming across the zone with special permission. This is Tiananmen Square on my left-hand side where the uprising took place. The enormous square is in Washington's corner. And beautiful and right behind it, I'm standing here, you can't see it. This is the world of the 1900s and the big sculptures describing the forehead. Tyranny of heritage. The Forbidden City is a spectacular place in which the emperor lives with all of his families, and I see all of his families many times, and that are families. The inside the city, I think we can sharpen that up in this plan. Is that sharp? A little sharp. You see the long entry that's through here, that's where we enter. And you look through all of these gates, all the way through the vast enclosure and the lines through the all the current lines into this compound, and the other lines that go over here. And there were stools, everything that you need, never went outside the wall. Well, on the right are the tiles, the gorgeous tile, the original one, on the railing, throughout the compound. And you can see how rich of color they were, how really beautifully designed. And they are repairing a lot of it, so it will remain as a historical place. The next place was, when we sharpen this, this is an almost perfect photo. What's happening up there? Somebody remember this? Oh, good. about building walls. There were walls to keep people out, there were walls to keep people in, there were walls everywhere, some 5,000 miles wide, not in borders. There were great measures to keep the various sectors of China out, and of course to keep people in as well. Rebuilding some of the walls which had fallen down. They're very large, they're very steep. I walked up to the east station, this was the first station going up, and it continues on and on. Some people walked all the way through the ones that were still constructed. These are the old walls, not the ones that were being reconstructed. And you can see them winding off from the hill. Spectaculars have to wonder about a people of culture that so intent on wall building, and they have walls within the city, walls around everything. It's a containment idea. You do a lot of thinking about it, because the idea of walls is a double-edged sword, or a knife that was in the the next slide I'm kind of thinking here, and I'm trying to cover a number of places. This is Sam's looking at Istanbul. Istanbul, a really great city. There's an old continental also. And then the Byzantines. And then finally the capital of the Ottoman Empire, which we gained so much of our own culture and what we know about government. This Sam's looking at on the right over there is Petra, big city, which was one of the huge trade centers of New York. And if you have a chance to go there, you will get to the city through the only entrance to the main, through this small slot. And the entire city is carved out of stone. That's where they live. Everything was carved out of stone. Absolutely overwhelming example of effort. And all of this, of course, we have probably undoubtedly historically of heavy handed rulers, slave labor, but the labor is a great pride, this is enough pride to be markedly illegal for many of the students. This is familiar for all of you. Many of you. You've seen in the Barcelona, the Garden of Venice. You find out that the photograph inside the course of the shell, still under construction, may never be completed. The real vision of this is architects who have enormous vision and have this dream to be a cathedral and died before it was completed. It is a fantasy, a real fantasy, very real in Barcelona. Here we come to two cities, of course, in Europe. I want to make it to the centric of the Pyrenees. Here we have Florence and Venice, both cultural centers, operated as cultural centers. One of the things about traveling, to me, has been the lesson learned that you study before you go, but you study more when you come back. I read more when I come back. In Venice, we missed a very important part of Venice. And that was the whole square that contained the Jewish settlement for 400 years, in which the idea of money exchange was invented, and a rich culture was invented and lived by the Jewish people who were contained in that square. There was only one entry to it. So we wouldn't have been able to have identified the height of the building had we known about it. Somehow I didn't know about it. And So when I came back, I thought, oh, we miss a lot. But all along, you keep enriching yourself by what you miss, and then you study more, and then you go back, and keep moving into this idea of more knowledge, more understanding of what you're looking at.
Again, I have my camera confiscated, taken away.
And we were there on a good point. Like 14-year-olds for a while who was banded together with shotguns. And my daughter said, I'm going to look back if we don't get the plane. I said, well, we'll move in with the ambassador. And my daughter said, why are we all doing these scary things? And I said, well, it gives us insight into the world. And your fears was causing it was the people that had nothing to do with you. Hungry on the streets. All the buildings had been unfortunately pulled out of all times. They sabotaged the water system, the electrical system, so that the good water was stored in the street. And people were left with nothing. It's like seeing the city of Chicago with nobody in the building. It was a deadly sight. And it didn't take me long to think, well, the concrete architects are very interesting. I feel like I'm traveling looking at poverty. And we better leave the chance if we can. So we lose here, and we look like people who don't belong there. So we managed to get out on the last plane of the week and got back to Swaziland. Since that time, that was a number of years ago, order is starting to be. But it was a deadly scene of poverty and the excesses of the culture that was imposed on the other country. This is the governor's palace and the nunnery over on the right. It's interesting, when I first saw this, I thought the stones were laid horizontally. Of course, they're laid in, you see, the stones, you see on the end of the stones. They go way back in. They never really learned the art of the dome, the half dome. They lived outside of the dome at the time. I thought that for a while that these might have been designed by women because of the textile nature of them, and I was told by the archaeologists on the site that the men did all the weaving. So that stops that idea. I mean, it didn't seem very much interesting to me anyway. It is some of the most exciting design, at least for me, that I've seen. Very detailed and yet very simple. Very straightforward. Frank Lloyd Wright is a little bit Richard Center in Wisconsin, almost copied some of this work. He had never been down to this area. I asked my comment how he did go into the political leader. Of course, he was a political leader and had ideas a long way. But it was my opportunity to be down to Lincoln and people and important parts of it. This is Baja Peninsula. There are some places you go, you don't see any. You know, architects are very threatening people because they see things where nothing exists. And we're a constant threat because that suggests change. And I think architects aren't always aware of that when we talk to people or work with people. But Baja Peninsula is one of the spectacular standalone buildings. On the right, of course, Diego Rivera, University of Mexico City. Right, the encompass architect, the architect, very easily, the artist is all part of the architect of Mexico. Sometimes we see things from the air. I usually sit on the aisle seat because I can work. I used to sit on the window. So I can see something. So it goes back and forth. Sometimes I don't fly at all and get in the car because I think I'm seeing everything looking down on top of it. And then it's time to get full smooth. So I drive a lot. But on the left-hand side is an atomic plant. On the right opposite side is opposite the building. From the air, there you go. Now moving into the modern period, more quickly, you have crowd aisle skins on the left. It's become a very popular form these days, which is called the Teflon coated canvas. They got it at the W International Airport, which many of you have seen. And people are cleaning how they use it, which is fairly easy when this is done. Sometimes the Expo in Montreal there. And on the right is Cabajac by Mosasaki, which I thought was a brilliant solution. The rose on the inside, and really enjoyed Cabajac. It's not in very good repair, and I think they have plans to do a repair job on it. Mosasaki has been active and becoming more active again. He's very active there, at this time, when that kind of state of view is not coming back, very brilliant. Combination of forms to handle identity. Paul Square, of course, also has that. I want to show a few of Frank Lloyd Wright's buildings, which certainly can't go through without showing some of Wright's really extraordinary design. This is Falling Water, one of the most beautiful houses in the world by the architects all over the world. When I went into this house, taken in weekend and early in the morning, and I walked into the living room, and I know a number of you have been there and visited and have had various responses. I walked in and I almost gave up architecture. I thought this is just as good. Why am I practicing architecture? And how can I justify? What I'm doing with this is so spectacular. Perhaps I should copy it. They just go live there and do nothing more. My life is a very totally satisfying feeling. I think a lot of people have this response when they walk into the living room, kitchen, site, everything just flows beautifully. They feel at peace and at peace. This is Kiley at the restaurant in the desert. Very indigenous to the materials of the desert. This is a developer today and works today. This is very much different today because we're getting more buildings. And recently they have received NAAB approval, accreditation. Of course, we're going to throw them into a new course and the school continues. I took my children in to see this. We arrived at about 12 o'clock midnight in the scene, and the cleaning crews were all in the cleaning building. We talked our way into the front door, and they let us walk through the whole building, through the research labs, everything, unescorted. Never had such a wonderful tour of the job of the wax, because normally you can't get in anymore. Johnson Tower, of course, has been closed. No longer meets the code. They'll decide what to do with it. It's magnificent. It's kept up beautifully. Wax floors, everything is perfect order. Anything that needs repair is repaired. But it's had absolutely no influence on the town whatsoever. And that's shocking. Imagine if you have a building like this standing, it's visited by thousands. Thousands of people. It was a working industry and it had no influence on the country. Yes? Can you focus the right slide? Because it's good to see people on the slide myself. Try that right slide. It's not very well focused. It seems like the slides are quite a bit of the earlier. There it is. There it is. opened up the entire so it's magnificently lit. Naturally, they are coming down, they opened it all up, making all closed up the offices and so forth. So it really now today is recognized for what it was designed to be, the temple for the display of non-objective art. And so there's always that question of whether you use daylight on natural paintings. Most curators might have known natural light, they might have artificial light. But most painters paint in natural daylight. So Wright's idea was that that's the way the paintings can be displayed. The Guggenheim venture in Venice, of course, fell through, which is too bad. It's a beautiful museum. It's gone to now, so none of it. And fun story, and it's good to see him. Wright was over there trying to get that museum up to Guggenheim in Venice. The reporters were busy tracking him down. And then the Hemingway was there at the same time. There is Hemingway lives across the street from the Wright in Oak Park. I was born in Oak Park in the Wright House. And father and mother had the garage and the apartment above the garage. And Hemingway lived across the street. And Hemingway is the Wright's office sparring all the way through the life. And so the reporters rushed over. They were having a referendum, I guess, on Wright's building in Venice. Said, no, we shouldn't have anything. You can keep this pink blocking there. You definitely didn't want it right to go with it. And so the reporters rustled them and talked to Hemingway, who was also in the city at the same time. And said, well, what do you think? And so they go, Frank, absolutely not terrible to build any kind of building. And so the reporters rushed back to Wright and said, Mr. Wright, you know, Hemingway's in town. He thinks definitely this building of yours should not be built. And Frank Lloyd Wright looked at the reporter and replied and said, ah, yes, the voice in the jungle. Always somehow came off the quiet response that sounded like a shout. And that was the beginning of the big scene that he moved and was never there. Roby House, of course, is now being restored. As up here, the University of Chicago had it, they're now restored. One of the great buildings in my book, in the world, Salt Institute, by Louis Kahn. I spent quite a bit of time here because we were working at the time with Francis Crick on the symposium of the Frontier of Medicine. The scientists. They just added, as you all know, this complex and focuses beyond. And the scientists were supremely happy here. They were able to do their work. A great testament to the design and cooperation of the science and architects. Here we are at Pompidou in France. Richard Rogers, I guess we call him Sir Richard Rogers now. I like him. The French hate. And it's actually, I think, extrapolating some of the detail of the Renaissance in the very open structure, space frame, with the escalators going up. You can see the whole city, the escalators. I thought it was a great success. Very encouraging. I am Pei, Fragrant Gardens, China, Hotel. I am Pei, the Chinese, tried to introduce to this historical fellow forms. Materials of the useful and modern architecture. It's one of the few examples of really good architecture, I think, in China. Most of it in 1950. high-rise, which is a big building, so fast, you can hardly believe it. I'm used to seeing five and trees, eight trees in the air. I've never seen 500 as far as this time. It's unbelievable the growth of time. And this was a really tiny hotel, but nobody knows how to keep it up and maintain it. Plants are dying. Nothing to take care of. Nothing to store. Nothing to work. Energy, of course, never works anywhere in China. So escalators, elevators are non-existent. In a few buildings, they last for a few years. It's a kind of tragedy of growth coming so very fast. The way that you want the future is going to be, and really a giant colossus, the largest one that I have ever seen, millions of people, and the chaos and confusion high. But Kiley did an interesting job here. And one slide called on. They are touching on these places and what they meant in a very probably superficial way, but in some way I'm going to talk about this. This is I am painting on the right, the left of the Forbidden City. And the emperor would sit at one end, and the four lions would cross. And the emperor would start drinking. When the wine got around to the other side, then they could start drinking as people were seated around. So often the emperor had a lot of wine before his guests had dinner. And so I'm faced with this scene of using the gardens outside of Brighton Hills. The idea is to do many things like this, making simple. That's a good one. Seems to have served this morning. Long time. This is, I came into Rostock with a long way out. All of you have been there. We rode for hours. It was not very regrettable when we saw it. It is a magnificent place. One has a feeling of walking inside a sculpture. And I think it is for probably ready to eat. And it's way there. All the windows on the inside. It's a very complex structure inside. This is Takamatsu. This is Takamatsu. It's a Ayana. It's a silk factory in Kyoto. Excellent workmanship, almost perfection. What this building has to do with silk manufacturing, however, is a very good question. He asked it. Takamatsu was there to greet us, and he went through it, and they made magnificent silk products. And we saw the silk being dyed and that. But the building was just this. Fantasy, really, in the middle of Kyoto, out of very rich materials, and the material that was being produced was rich, beautiful. Everything was beautiful, but we couldn't quite put it all together. We would ask these questions, of course, never the answers, but much bowing. And so we came up and Katie is an entrepreneur and mentioned in the fellow of architects. I also saw a lot of Dale Hundo's work. Paul Rudolph on the right, in Hong Kong, and on the left, Hong Kong, Warren Foster's Bank, I think. Hong Kong is the, as you know, the largest, highest density in the world, on an island, 6.5 million people. The city really works. It is, I think, a testament to the fact layers of transportation, the subways are down here. That's on the train from the subway to down here. And then on top of that are the service roads. And then come the streets. The service roads take all the trucks down the middle of the street. So we don't have a terrible mass to do an update. And the streets here. And above the streets are the walkway, you go over. You don't have traffic. Any traffic, walk on walkways, walk the street. When you get up to the walkways on escalators, and then if you want to get up to the back hill, which goes up to Victoria Peak, go up on escalators, go right up to the back street, and tip off, and then the street and walk to the officer. And then, of course, you have the boats and the highway. Bay. And then the Hong Kong is all really mixed use. We have the retail at the bottom, the hotel, floor 2 to floor 10, the school, floor 10 to floor 14, the great parkway stretching between buildings, 16 to the 20th floor, apartment buildings from the 20th to the 60th floor, and maybe an industrial. And all through Hong Kong, you have this vertical mixed use. So that at no time, day or night, is everybody pouring out on the sidewalk as they go in New York City and all over the city. What happens is that at night, lights are everywhere. You see the people living in their apartments, and it's light. Light is I was there for 2 weeks, and my host, who drives through the tunnels from 75 miles an hour on the freeway, and we would shoot right through, and I said, how do you shoot these cars so fast on the freeway right in the center of the city? And because they charge, they go through the tunnel. What happens in the case of I said, I really find this incredible. So simple. The system is so simple. It made it such a conflict. And I said, what happens if you do something wrong when you want to cross the lanes, never cross the lanes. And they said, oh, it's simple. Yeah, as the police car goes out, goes over. I envision the traffic court, the terrible kind of the dreadful tropes that go on and on and on. There's thousands of people trying to get this chicken salad. And my husband said, well, nothing happens. He just leans over and takes the things off your window here. And then you have to go the way over here on the other side, you have to stop. Pay, as opposed to, you can't go through on through. And I said, well, you pay, you can get the people who go through the federal. And I said, well, that seems very reasonable, very simple. You don't have to go to court and help them be part of that. And so I was going up the escalator once, a woman fell on the escalator, and people got her up, and they said, she was all right. And I said, no, we lot of frivolous suits going on in our country. Somebody would then sue the company or the city or whatever that has played. And said, hell no, no, that never happened. You fall down, take care of yourself. Stop falling down. and on the freeways, there was people walking on the freeway, and I said, well, no, in our country, we don't allow people to walk on the freeway. It's very dangerous. The entry is very dangerous. And I said, now what happens if the person gets hit? Well, he said he gets hit. And I said, there's nobody would touch that. What's the fool doing walking out the street? The idea of individual responsibility, you know, I thought, well, we have something to learn here. Take hold of it. Do something responsible. Hong Kong is absolutely exciting with no holes, no reason otherwise.
Young sculptor worked on it, and
We always had thousands of volunteers to work with them to put up these gigantic statements. We went on the riding horses to the running fence in California, and the sense it almost got the wall of China, the China wall. You know, you mentioned in the session now how you get through ingress, egress, and the running fence stayed up for 14 days. Many years making a great cross, we dug. This is the Australian coast that was wrapped up. There's an enormous amount of architecture, but trying to confront the idea of form, of form is, how it presents itself. The one on the right is the Kansas City walkway, much more modest project. This is more elaborate. This is Whispering Bay. This island phenomenon, the beauty of it, some of the critics populated saying it's only recycled impressionist. And so, what most of us look at this as a very creative, innovative way to call attention to the island phenomenon. These are the umbrella projects from 1700 in the United States and 1300 in Japan. Blue ones were in Japan, yellow ones were in the United States. And they actually, in Christo's mind, represented houses, the intensity of housing, displacement on the landscape of housing, the idea of approaching growth and how we look at growth and development. Stayed up 3 weeks and then we were taken down. The latest that was done this year was the wrapping of the Wright stock in Germany. There were 90 rock climbers who helped put that silver cloth up, translucent aluminum total pattern. And something like 5 million people attended. This slide is the Wright stock is one of the most famous government buildings in the world. I'll say famous and infamous. The Bunkers of Hitler, which he died in the Wright stock. This was a statement, a very strong statement, wrapping up a building of enormous historical influence that eventually resulted in the Great Depression. It was debated. The Berlin people loved it. South America was writing a kind of statement that Christo, I think, would be congratulated for his eventual attack. Next four slides, my final slides, are on the my latest building. So after all this, they are so what, I must say. So what has she seen in many? And does influence you in some way? Should it have? This is a passive. It's just been completed. There's a 150-foot cliff on the other side. Some part of it here. Down the part of the blade, concrete block, and played by 16 blades of the circuit. And the garage, in our garage, is attached by an 80-foot long walkway so that all weather is connected to all weather. This is the cliff right off the edge, and through this entire building with a 60-foot truck security in it. And I think you can see the glass when you come out to the side. And this truss is the plant geologist and the soil engineer is exactly right, with the new soil doesn't say, as a, didn't say that the roads of the scale are going underneath, and the odds were already at positions at the top, and I was standing on one side of the fissure towards the tip side, and the geologist was standing there, and I said, well, what are the odds here? He said, well, he said it would be a million years, or it fell, the devil, or it could be as we're standing there. And I didn't go near the tip to that, that was a bad odd. And so, about 9 feet away from the cliff, and I put this cantilever, 25 foot cantilever, truss out, you can walk out on it. Marvelous feeling in space with the red light in the distance. And the pool is on the terrace. This is where the truss comes to the inside of the building. You can go upstairs and manages to take the light at the head. And on the right is the dining room and down there to the marvelous mountain room. The mountain room is full of light.
Thank you.
shown me that you don't need to do this. I mean, there's a great change that has evolved in other places. And why here in this country we are going backwards, more and more backwards, to preserve things. I wish somebody had a good answer for this. I thought the shelter was very fancy about it, because out of California with all the not any new urbanism we're talking about for 40 years, but it's recycling again, so it comes in, and we have to go through the whole business, and hopefully somebody catches the idea of it. But what is it that makes us not move forward with new ideas, new change in the form, if we are to evolve as people? We're being asked to evolve as people very fast now. There's very little time in which to accommodate what seems to be the bad environments. And I consider most of the historic stuff bad environments. There are very few buildings for which they were safe. And those should be safe. But that's what's happened with all this travel. And we're more exasperated than ever with our inability to have a very broad view and intelligent view. That doesn't really answer your question. Another
question? How many of you have been to China? Good. 1, 2.
Is that all? 3.
Somebody else, though. I think that there is a reason to preserve our buildings. Because today we don't build the way we used to do. If the public building is something that you accept as the replacement for beautiful downtown, what used to be Muncie, then that obviously is your opinion. But I don't think that's what you're saying. You're saying you should look forward. Another kind of building. The problem is that the majority of America is not being built that way. So, other than building for the very wealthy, how can we preserve our cities, which are massive developments in our society?
By repair and by infill. And the infill is where your imagination should be brought into play. We have all across this country this god-awful neo-Draconian stuff all over the place. It's sitting on lots and sites that go 3 and 4 stories high. You've got the 3-car garage. This is not really wealthy people. This is middle America who has finally arrived and they're now the arbiters of taste. And they're sitting there on their land with what I call gated communities of the mind. And you can't get in or move these mines. Developers, in the sense, have won. It's all over the landscape. It won't last out the 30 years of its mortgage because it's badly built. And we're saddled with this kind of thinking that is what we call new thinking. And what I just said a while ago, it can be, you could look and say, well, that's what she's talking about. I'm not talking about that. I think that's a great tragedy because the infill is happening with this mystical kind of developments that so inhibits the really good growth patterns. And it's why I think we have to think through the idea of how would we do it better, not simply preserving, but how could we do it better? How can we do this planning better? How can we do the building better? And so I'm not at issue with what they're saying, but I think we're talking about the quality of something and what you're doing, rather than the idea of new or old. I mean, would you have us preserve everything in the town within the city? Would you?
No, I would not be preserving everything for preservation's sake. I was actually making a similar point for once earlier. Not to have such an optimistic view of our society. I'm not to
cannot afford to scroll, cannot afford going out.
and they haven't got the message. And these are intelligent, educated people who feel that they can, you know, their heart and soul and energy to provide to have my land. And in my backyard, nothing will grow. It's all over the church. And I don't know whether you see that here monthly or not. You don't, because it may not be the kind of growth we know it's going to.
Thank you.